This week on the Grassroots Podcast.
Some scouts actually came and said, they said they were interested. They've been looking at myself, and I was like, I didn't really like take any notice of it. And I was like, oh damn, this could be my shot. Having that confidence in yourself saying, yes, I can do it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to try. I'm going to do my best. And if I don't succeed, hopefully something else opens up.
I'm your host, Quincy Kennedy, and you're hanging out with us in Thought Fox Studio One, also known as the Fox Den. And we have an exciting episode today with an exciting guest. We're here with Lachlan Wells. How are we doing, Lachlan?
Pretty good. How are you doing?
I am fantastic. Thank you for asking. And as always, co-host Els, I almost call you Mels. Els is in the building. How are we doing, Els?
I'm good. How are you, Q?
I am just doing splendid.
Oh, that's wonderful to hear.
Yes, it's really good.
Sounds really sarcastic. Sorry.
That's all right. We're a sarcastic group of people here. So, Lachlan, this is the first time on the podcast.
No. Second time.
Sports Fest. But the Sports Fest.
Yeah,
yes,
you weren't there.
I wasn't
for that.
There. So, this is my first time interviewing Lachlan, though. Hey, this is the very first two-time. The first person who's been on the show twice.
Yeah.
Did I get a medal?
Yes.
Well,
a golden star.
We're celebrating that and his thousandth follower
on social, Instagram,
all
or Facebook.
All the celebrations.
Yeah, get around it.
Yeah, there you go. So a bit about our friend Lachlan. Signed with Major League Baseball team Minnesota Twins in 2014 when he's only 17. I think we're still in high school at 17.
I wasn't signing professional contracts when I was 17.
Definitely not. Ah, man. So this happened when he drew some attention to himself from a few Major League scouts after playing at the 2012 National Championship at the age of only 15, representing Australia at the Under 18 World Cup in Taiwan. Played for the Cedar Rapids Colonels, minor league baseball team, and that's actually the previous season he played with them. Also played with the Sydney team. Remind me of their name.
Sydney Blue Sox.
Yeah. I'm just White Sox, Red Sox, Blue Sox. I know the Red and White Sox history, but I don't know what the Blue Sox really stand for. Like, I don't know if that's their own kind of Yankee. I don't know, but...
Well, I'm assuming they're the Blue Sox because they're New South Wales, and New South Wales colors are blue.
Well, that's original.
That's pretty much what it
that's
is.
That's all I'm going off.
Too many color socks. That's pretty much what it comes down to.
That's awesome. Well, again, Lachlan, super pumped to have you on. Again, you have quite the resume. I'm not going to read through the whole list, but you definitely have quite the baseball experience, and that's why we want you on, because baseball is definitely a grassroots sport here. It's pretty big, but I guess comparing it to AFL or rugby, cricket, I think it's definitely grassroots, but I definitely see it on the rise.
Yeah,
so
definitely.
Before we get started though, Q's word of the week.
Yes.
Guys, pretty pumped for this one. I'm good. I've been on this like end of the year trip, so I'm getting everybody prepared to like smash into 2017. So
all right, lay it on us.
Yeah, I'm gonna lay it on you. Ready? 3, 2, 1. Word of the week is systems.
Systems.
Having
interesting
systems, right? So it's December. There's a lot of things like we talked about last week with the word of week, change, right? If nothing changes. But how do we get to change? Creating systems.
Oh, I see.
Creating systems.
I think that's a bit of a system right there. Look at you go.
Yeah. Some of the most successful people create systems, right? Like even like you think about not Warren Buffett, why am I thinking of that? Can't think of his name. This is pretty embarrassing. But Zucks. Yes, Facebook Zucks. And Steve Jobs, right? They wear the same clothes every day, right? It's a system. They have the same morning routine. A lot of successful people, most millionaires, have a morning routine or just a system that is conscious for them. Like, they don't have to think about it. Same thing going into 2017. The things that we need to change, let's create systems. Rather, we know every morning I wake up at 5 o'clock. I do 10 push-ups. I get a cup of water. You know, not
see,
about the waking up.
And I've already talked about this. 5 o'clock is not a good time for us.
It's not a good time.
5 o'clock is not a good time for anyone. That's how it should be. It's 5 o'clock for a reason.
It's 5 o'clock somewhere. But, right, so more of the story is, though, is creating systems so that that change can happen for 2017, creating all kinds of systems in relationships, in our day-to-day activity, rather it's our workout or our morning routine, our nightly routine, getting our plan ready, getting our clothes ready for the morning so we wake up, boom, we're right on it, creating systems in our workplace, even creating systems in athletics. You know, there's players who, I know, like some of the best, like Kobe Bryant had a system when it came to practicing and shooting. Jordan had a system, right? Some of the best baseball players, I'm sure.
Definitely.
Systems. So what do you guys take on that?
I don't have systems. I'm hearing you talking and I'm just like, no, I don't have a system. Pretty much roll out of bed, have a shower. That's my system.
Just free to air, huh?
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, I don't know. Hey, I'm not a systematic person. I'm organized, but I'm not systematic.
Mm.
So maybe I'm never going to be successful.
Maybe. That's not true. I'm just saying that it's a good word to take in and apply to your life.
Yeah.
But organized, I think, is right along there, having systems. Mm. Yeah. A lot.
In the off season, no systems. But definitely during the season, there's definitely systems, a lot of systems that happen during the day. Yeah. If it's getting out of bed, going to the field, getting to the field, doing what I have to do before the game, during the game, after the game.
Give me a practical example. So during practical season, what's a system that you guys have in place?
All right. Do you want my system? Or?
Yeah, let's see your system.
All right,
yeah.
My system. So obviously get out of bed. Could be 10:30, 11 o'clock, midday. But get out of bed.
So we miss breakfast, all right?
I cook myself something for brunch.
Brunch, yeah. Brunch. Yeah. Brunch is where it's at.
Yeah, definitely a little bit of brunch. And then, go to the field, stop off and get something for lunch and just sit there and enjoy a nice bit of probably Subway or McDonald's or something, whatever I can get, whatever's cheapest, and sit there and talk to all the other guys before we have to get out there and go to for practice before our game. So we get there, get changed, get ready to go, stretch, roll out, just get loose, get ready for the day, get out there.
Does that make going into the game easier, knowing that you have that system in place where you know that when I get there, I know I'm going to head to the locker room, chat with the guys for a bit. Then I know at this time we may have a pregame meal. And then I know right after that we're stretching. Yeah. Does that kind of ease your mind so you're a little bit less stressed for a game? Or?
I wouldn't say like I'm stressed for the game, but if everything's running smoothly, just like means, I don't know, everything's going good for the day. Like there's no stress. We're just going through our daily routine that we need to do to get ready for the game, and everyone's just like in a good mood.
Yeah,
there's comfort in routine.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah,
definitely.
And I think when you're going through the motions of, you know, going through those systems, those routines, it's kind of like muscle memory. You know, you know you can get where you want to go because you're relying on knowing you've put the practice in.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Definitely. Yeah,
helps create those habits.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Well, just because you're wondering, I am putting some systems together starting December, right? Because this is like the perfect opportunity to get some momentum. They say 30 days creates a habit. So I have a few things I'm working on to smash out before we get into the new year. I'm telling you guys, I am crushing 2017.
Good work.
Like,
heard it here first.
Yeah. Heard it here first. Crushing 17. Oh, man, that's good.
We need to put that on a poster, like a motivational poster.
Yeah.
crush 2017.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. What we do is use the same quote before different pictures so we can all use it.
And heck, we could even make a calendar. I'm sure I've got enough photos of you.
Yeah, that's right. Why wouldn't you want a photo of me?
2017.
Bonza.
Yeah, 2017 Grassroots calendar featuring all of you.
All different sides of me. Just
I'd buy it.
That's right.
He's your number one fan.
I'll autograph it for you, by the way. That's fair.
Sounds good.
Yeah, that's right. Awesome. Well, more importantly, guys, we're talking to Lach today all about baseball. Mm-hmm. So the season here has kicked off. MLB has just finished up with the Cubs taking it. Mm-hmm. Ooh, before I get too deep, how do you feel about that? Cubs just took it, right?
I was rooting for the Cubs this year. As soon as, like, Twins didn't really play good this year, so the Cubbies.
It's because you weren't there.
Yeah.
That's exactly it.
No comment.
Very wise move.
Yeah.
Sorry, I won't provoke anymore.
Yeah, so the Cubbies playing good, and then they clinched the playoff spot. I think it was, like, nearly a month before the playoffs.
Yeah.
So they were obviously crushing it, and then had that momentum going into the playoffs, and they were just making every other team look pretty bad, and then they got to the World Series, got a little bit of a shake up by the Indians, and then game five it was, they just came out and just turned it on and
didn't look
back. So
So what history was made there? How long has this been?
108 years.
108 years.
Yeah.
Could you imagine?
Jeez.
And I think they broke a record for like the world's largest after party as well. Like I saw big gathering in the field.
Yeah, the street parade. I think no one went to work. I think everyone went to the street parade and
that's how you
downtown saw, right? Chicago.
That's good. But yeah, well, congrats for Chicago. I mean, that's fantastic. Absolutely. That's awesome. Mm-hmm. I think it really kind of emphasizes losing culture versus winning culture. You know, mm-hmm. what clicked for them? 108 years of losing.
Yeah.
You know, but then you have, you know, this 2016 season where they just turned it up and they took it and broke that streak.
I wonder if they even knew it was 108 years, like before, you know,
they knew it was a long time.
I'm sure you read the papers and social media.
I'd be curious to know if they did know it was 108 years before they won it, because that's when everyone was like, oh, it's been 108 years in the making.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm just curious.
Well, I mean, if they can do it, then Detroit Lions have a chance. So we'll see. But more importantly, let's talk about what baseball looks like here. So, Locke, for someone who doesn't know baseball, can you just give us a 30-second elevator pitch? What is baseball? How many players are on the field? Just give us a bit of background on what baseball is.
All right. Baseball, you've got two teams, nine to a team. You got a nine positions on the field: pitcher, catcher, first base, second base, third base, shortstop, left, center, and right field.
Yep.
Idea is, if you, as a pitcher, you gotta want to try and get the hitter out.
That's your job. You're a pitcher.
That's my job.
Yep.
Either by striking them out, getting the field to on a ground ball, throw it to first base, or by them hitting a fly ball and field is catching it.
Yep.
Obviously, as a hitter, you want to get to first base or get home, score runs. Obviously, hit the ball, run to first base, getting safe, and trying to get your other teammates to get you around until you get to home plate and score.
There you go. Or just knock out home runs.
Or just hit the ball over the fence.
There you go.
And there's a home run. There you go.
Absolutely. That's
pretty much what it is.
Cool.
So how do you win a baseball game?
Scoring more runs than the opposition.
Okay.
And there's nine innings?
Nine innings.
Yep.
Nine
innings. I remember the seventh inning stretch.
Yeah, the seventh inning stretch.
Yeah.
Yeah. Get someone to sing, take me out to the ball game. And, good fun.
Actually, I used to know the Toronto Blue Jays stretch song. I forgot it, though. But we used to always go to Toronto games when they were still the Sky Dome. So definitely have childhood memories there. Mm-hmm. But let's talk about your history in baseball. So, again, I mentioned a bit briefly in the beginning your background. But I guess talk to us about how you got started and what baseball was for you growing up. And then we'll get into present day.
Cool. Well, I started playing cricket, soccer, did all the athletics, swimming, did all the other sports. And then my godfather, who actually coached at and played for Belmont Baseball Club, said, why not come down and have a go? Plus, we saw when we were playing cricket, we saw come and try days. So obviously, we're going to go there and have a go. And started playing t-ball, aged 9 or 10.
Yeah,
Started playing and then never looked back since.
Mm. Yeah, I think 9 or 10, that's, I want to say it's bantams in the States by then. Like, you wouldn't be playing t-ball still. 9 or 10.
At 9, playing t-ball or
pitch machine.
Yeah, pitch machine.
Yeah, yeah, right.
Yeah,
okay.
So they're doing that and then obviously going up to Little League. Under 14s, under 16s, and under 18s.
Absolutely. So what, I guess, grabbed your attention? Again, you said you're playing cricket, soccer, these other sports, but then baseball comes along. What grabbed your attention?
Actually, watching it on TV.
Yeah.
Saw it on TV. I was like, I want to play that. And then started to, like, get into it, like, watch it a bit more. And I was like, damn, I really want to play in front of all those people.
Yeah.
Under the lights, pitching. I couldn't even remember the games that we're watching, but it was interesting. I enjoyed watching it, and so I was like, yeah, I'm gonna play that one day. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna go and play professional baseball, and went and tried my hand at t-ball, and yeah, never looked back.
That's right.
How long did you play for Belmont for?
Played from obviously t-ball right through to when I started, or during under 16s, and then got out of under 16s and started playing grade. Played fourth grade, third grade, second grade, and first grade.
With Belmont, or did you have to move around?
No, with Belmont. Oh. Yeah, last season was in 2014, the year that I signed.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, right.
Belmont through and through.
Yeah, that's it.
That's right? Hometown
he's
hero.
He's ripping.
Yeah, he is. That's it. So I guess how long has Belmont actually had a club? So how does the baseball work here? So in the States, I know you play in little leagues, mm-hmm. and it's kind of like a community thing. So yep. you have like the township league. Mm-hmm. So we had North and Southfield, and it was two separate leagues. Then we got to majors. You would play each other, and whatnot, and then you go into high school baseball, and then into college baseball, and then et cetera. How does it work here? Is it like most sports in Australia where there's clubs?
Yeah, it's like most sports where we have a club, because you don't really play like. All schools don't play like in competitions.
Yeah.
So you have the clubs and so play obviously even with AFL, rugby, rugby league, cricket, they all have clubs.
Yep.
And so obviously with Belmont, you have your juniors, which is obviously T-ball, little league, under 14s, under 16s. And then after under 16s, you either can go and play in like 6th, 5th and 4th grade, which is like minor leagues, which is like it's like not the best level of competition, but it's still for the guys that have finished, wouldn't say old guys, but like the guys that still want to play and they're not at the elite level anymore. So they play down there, and even the young kids coming through, they'll play there to start with and try and get better to end up playing in third, second and first grade, which yeah. is the major league. First grade is obviously the elite one, the elite elite group of people in Newcastle playing against each other, and yeah, that's pretty much it.
Oh yeah.
What does the league look like? So you played for Belmont, but who did you play against in first grade?
Well, they have a team in Nelson's Bay, in Maitland, mm-hmm. and then you've got the University Toronto have a team. Lakers, which is on like pretty much the other side of the highway, right. there have a team.
Right around the Hunter, or did you go out to Sydney at all?
No, well, for winter comp, which is the Newcastle Hunter Port Stephens comp, that's who we played against in the winter time, mm-hmm. and then in the summertime, we'd go down, or myself and my brother would go and play in the Sydney comp down there because we don't have the summer comp up here due to not having the fields because of cricket and.
That gets old, doesn't softball. It? Man.
Traveling to Sydney?
Yeah, traveling to Sydney to play sports or not having field space because of cricket and rugby.
Yep.
That gets old. Like, we're experiencing that with lacrosse. Like, we're a newer sport in the area, so we have no chance. Like, we're scratching and clawing to get field.
Yeah, it's tough. It's definitely tough trying to get field space, but obviously the popular sport is going to take over.
Yeah.
But
which is sad because sports don't grow that way.
No, it doesn't. But if you still like, it's just a matter of getting that group of people, all just speaking, having a voice, and speaking up, and trying to grow the competition. And
absolutely,
it may take time, but for that time, it does. There's gonna be people out there that are gonna thank those people for doing it.
Yeah,
because they get the opportunity to play summer and winter. And yeah, it's going to make the competition a lot stronger, and it's going to get more people to come and play baseball.
Absolutely. And that's what it's all about, right? Growing our grassroots sports, getting out there, being a voice and advocate for it so it can grow. Because as you mentioned, you've had opportunity to go play overseas, play professionally, travel, play with different teammates and build new relationships. So grassroots sports, especially in Australia, there's so much opportunity that it can present. So I kind of want to elaborate. I want to kind of get into that a bit. So I guess, when did you finally realize, like, man, I'm legit. Like, I'm a good player. Like, I want to pursue this. Because you said, like, early on, you're like, I want to play that. I want to be under the lights. But when did it really click for you? And I guess, what did you do at that point?
I wouldn't say that I was legit or good. But when I was playing in the national championships, when I got selected to go and play for New South Wales Country at nationals, going through those age groups, under 14s, under 16s, I got to my second year of under 16s and had a pretty good tournament. Got golden arm, which is best pitcher down at the tournament. I was like, and then some scouts actually came and said, they said they were interested. They've been looking at myself. And I was like, I didn't really like take any notice of it. And I was like, oh damn, this could be my shot. I gotta keep working hard and playing good, and hopefully one day someone offers me something didn't matter what it was, money, like money, plane ticket, I wouldn't have cared. If someone offered me something to go and play professional baseball, I was going to take it.
Mm.
So what was it like when you finally got that contract, when that contract was in front of you? What was that like then?
The day that I was signing the contract, I was nervous, didn't really sleep the night before. I was like, oh, damn, this is going to happen.
yeah.
I was like,
that's right.
Yeah, this is cool. This is what I want to do. Like,
did you have that whole dreams have come true kind of moment? Or, you know, you were just thinking about it like, oh, wow, I'm going to sign this tomorrow. Like, wow.
It wasn't like the dreams have come true. Like, it didn't really sink in for a couple of weeks. And then when I realized that I got my flight details to go over to America, I'm like, all right, it's happening. It's happening. But no, when the contract was sat in front of me, obviously went through it all and it's like, all right, this is nerve-wracking. There's the scout sitting next to me goes, do you understand all this? And with my parents, I'm like,
nah. I was going to say, where were your parents?
Yeah, hopefully they understand it because I'm not really thinking straight. But it was a nerve-wracking experience, but pleasing one to know that I've worked hard and I've been given the opportunity and someone likes what they see. And yeah, and I signed that. Signed that dotted line and there I was, professional athlete professional baseball player with the Minnesota Twins.
Just going back a little bit, your parents. So I assume your parents have been very supportive like all through this. Like what are they kind of, how do they kind of view your, you know, pursuit in life, you know, to be a professional baseballer?
They're obviously very proud of myself and my brother for going out and signing
both you and your brother, your twins, and you both play professional ball.
Yep. Yeah, so very proud, obviously. Mm. Not many parents can say that their son's a professional athlete and especially in baseball in Australia.
Yeah.
So they were very proud and happy. So it was good to see them have a big smile on their face when they know that I've sort of at the next step of reaching my dream.
Yeah.
And they just said, just keep working hard. This is only the start. And
so good.
Yeah, just go and get it.
A couple of things you mentioned, and which I just want to dive into. You mentioned your dream a few times, which I love that, right? Like, I feel like so many people, as we get older, we start taking our dreams off the wall, and people tell us, you know, think practically, or, you know, it's reality, and we go to 9 to 5, we give up on our dreams. So you mentioned dreamed a couple of times, but you're such a great example of an Australian native who pursued their dreams, pursued their goals in athletics, and the opportunity that has opened up. So, because, as most people would know, but there may be some people who think you're an overnight success. Mm-hmm. Can you elaborate on like those systems again, back to where the day systems, and the things that you put in place before you got those calls or got recognized at the Nationals? Like, what were you doing on a daily basis? Like, how many balls were you hitting a day? You know, how many pop flies were you working on? How many ground balls were you working on? Like, what was your daily routine? Like, I'm sure you're not good for no reason. Can you just like give those listeners, those kids out there who really want to pursue sport, give them a taste of what it really takes?
Well, it's just really just throwing in the backyard with my brother. It was pretty much every day. Grab the ball, like we'd get home from school. Like schoolwork was the second option to me. Like doing homework, I was like, I don't really want to do that. I want to go outside and play catch or go and play catch or do something. So it was just throwing in the backyard or going up to the field. And yeah, it was just pretty much that. Just throwing the ball every day, throwing bullpens or just playing catch, just like it might seem stupid, but mucking around in the backyard, like just working on different stuff, it just helps. Like everything, just getting out there and doing it. Just like don't like say, oh, I don't really want to do it. But if you really want to like reach that next level, you just got to do it. Getting out there, throwing every day, it's huge. It's pretty much.
So you just kept the glove in your hand 24/7. Play as much as you can.
Pretty much.
Yeah. Like,
you couldn't. It'd be dark and we'd still be outside throwing or doing something. You just couldn't get myself or my brother away from it.
Absolutely. Did you do any specialized coaching at all? Or did you get extra coaching or, you know, anything like that? Or is it just literally just all you doing that work and you playing games and doing the regular club coaching, that sort of thing?
No, we had. I went to the Hunter Academy.
Oh, yeah.
Obviously, Hunter Academy of Sport. Mm-hmm. Did the baseball program there since I was 13 or 14, yeah. Right up until my last year. I think it was like under 18s.
No, yeah.
So did that Monday and Wednesday. And then when we started, playing at a high level, going to the Australian Baseball Academy, which would involve us going to Sydney twice a week to train as well.
Okay, yeah.
So going down there Tuesday and Thursday, training every week for like 10 weeks before the Australian Baseball Academy. So, yeah, it was a lot of training, a lot of hours in the car.
And then even more hours in the backyard.
Yeah, even more hours in the backyard, pretty much not stopping, being told to stop throwing by our coaches. And then we would just go out there and do it anyway. And then when your coach would come to see you at your house and you're out there throwing, you used to run inside. No, we weren't doing anything. We were just joking around. We weren't throwing or anything like that. So they used to catch a coach caught us doing that one day. And, but you couldn't keep us out of the backyard. It was never inside. So I think that really helped as well.
I think it's Malcolm Gladwell who mentions in his book, I don't think he's the original thought leader of this concept, but I know he brings it up, which he may be, I don't know. Anyway, he brings up the 1,000-hour rule, I think it is. You know, where you have to practice something for 1,000 hours, become a professional or become an expert. Mm-hmm. I feel like that's a low number. 1,000 hours, is that it?
It's 1,000.
Yeah. Fact checks. Huh. Anyway,
facts don't matter. Doubting myself.
Yeah, I'm thinking, but
I wasn't going to answer it because I've got no idea.
Yeah, no. So Malcolm Gladwell talks about the 1,000-hour rule, you know, that it takes 1,000 hours of practice to become an expert at something. And that's what I hear you saying. Even when I think about, my brother JFK and all the hours he put in with hockey, it was the same thing. Like, we'd be in the house, right? So it's carpet. Like, you're not stick handling, but he'll get like a golf ball and he's just stick handling. And he's shooting at, like, we had a Sega Genesis and he puts like the boxes up in corners, like it was like a net and they're like targets. And he's just ripping shots at our games, you know, just getting, and you could not stop him. And it is 10,000 hours. That's what it is. Thanks, Mick.
Thanks,
the producer. 1,000 hour rule. 1,000 hours is
lit. I knew it had a zero.
Something like that. But yeah, it's just the repetition. And that's what I hear that you're saying. Yeah, that you were. And you even went to that elite level where you got with the Hunter Academy of Sports, got with them, got that extra training, and then going to Sydney and making those sacrifices. So what I hear from you is just putting in the time and making sacrifices. And I'm sure you had a lot of coffee when you were traveling and
no coffee. A lot of sleep.
Well, maybe you should try some Glee coffee. That'll keep you awake, man. Forget sleep. You need to stay awake.
Get on the Glee. Introduce some Glee into your life.
Yeah, introduce some Glee into your life. I'm burning up because I've been drinking so much coffee. I took my shirt off. I'm sweating.
You look like you're sweating bullets, man.
But no. Thank you for that insight, Locke. And I guess for a young person listening to the show, what would you tell them if they said, you know, what would you tell the 15-year-old Locke, or if you would, some kid listening right now, what would you tell them that it takes to be successful? What would you tell them about their dreams and their goals?
Obviously not to give up. You're gonna be told that you're not good enough. I got told that I wasn't good enough, and obviously proved that person wrong.
Yeah,
and it proved a lot of people wrong. So yeah, just don't give up, keep at it, and just work hard. That's all you can do. Just having the right work ethic and just
confidence in yourself.
And confidence is a big thing as well. Like, if you obviously gonna get those people that are doubting you and saying that you're not good enough, like, obviously then you can just say, oh, obviously I'm not good enough and I don't want to try anymore. But having that confidence in yourself, saying, yes, I can do it, I'm gonna do it, I'm gonna try, I'm gonna give it my best, and if I don't succeed, hopefully something else opens up where I can. Like, obviously if it's not professional, it's college.
Yeah.
Or yeah, just college baseball, even like just going on a touring team to go and play in America. Like, it's a goal that you could have for yourself. So pretty much just don't give up. That's all I got.
No, that's good. If I was 15-year-old, I would take that and run with it. So appreciate that. So let's talk about the MLB season, last season. So we know Chicago took it, but let's talk about your season specifically and how you guys did and what you did. And yeah, let's give our listeners a bit of that experience.
Well, I went over in March for spring training. Went to spring training, was in the extended rookie ball squad. Obviously, they obviously didn't think that I was going to make a team out of spring training, a full season team. So I stayed in extended spring training, just worked hard, pretty much getting up at 6 every day, getting there to the field early, or going to have breakfast, getting to the field early, doing everything I could to make myself better. Then we'd train in from 9 till about 11:30, and then we'd play games from 1 till whenever they finished after the 9 innings, and then pretty much go back to the dorms and have downtime, just hang around, play PlayStation, just sit in your room. That'd be pretty much time when everyone in Australia is getting up, so you talk to the family, talk to your friends. And then so I did that for a couple months, and then it was one day I got called into the minor league coordinator's office, thought I was in trouble. I don't know what's going on here. And then they're like, oh, we're gonna keep you down here in the GCL for now. And like, I was like, oh, all right, what's going on? Like, oh, it's only until Thursday. I'm like, what are you doing? And he goes, all right, you're going to Cedar Rapids to play in the Cedar Rapids Colonels team. I was like, oh, all right, that's better.
Thinking you were staying in as a rookie.
Yeah, and then got the call up and was pretty excited about that. Called mum. She was sound asleep, but she needed to know, and told mum. Like, mum, going up. And
she was woke up pretty fast.
She woke up pretty fast. She was pretty happy for me. And she's like, all right, I'm going back to sleep. I was like, all right, fine. So I did my daily routine again for the last time. Did that, packed my bag, or had my bag packed, because I was originally going to Elizabethton, Tennessee. I was about to jump on a 14-hour bus ride there. No planes in minor league baseball. And so did that, was there for an extra couple of days, jumped on a plane at 6 a.m., flew to Atlanta, then Atlanta to Cedar Rapids, landed in Cedar Rapids and went straight to the field, dropped all my gear off, and walked into the clubhouse, and I was like, yeah,
this is a real deal.
Yeah, this is good. This is different.
Awesome.
This is better than down in Florida. So yeah, did that, and then I was pitching on the Sunday. It was like the last game of the series against the Beloit Snappers. That's the Oakland Athletics, low A affiliate. So I pitched against them through 5 innings, 5.1 innings. Didn't give up any runs. Gave up a couple hits and struck a couple people out.
Studly.
And so I was like, all right, that's my debut done. So got that one out of the way.
I can just imagine you like walking off, you're like, yep.
Instead of dropping the mic, he drops the glove.
Yeah, it wasn't really that, but I felt like happy, surprised, like all the emotions were going, like, damn, I actually did that.
Yeah.
And then just got on with the season.
It sounds like you're on a funny kind of journey. Like, you know, you've signed this contract and you have such overwhelming emotions, you know, then you're in the rookies and then you get such overwhelming emotions again when you go up, and you're from here, you're only going up still. Like, so I don't know what comes next when you're actually in the Twins team playing. Like,
where's the pennant?
Yeah.
It's a big roller coaster, minor league baseball, but so we finished the season. We actually clinched a playoff spot. We swept Clinton, the Lumber Kings, the Seattle Mariners affiliate. They were the top team. We swept them in 4 games at home, and we clinched the playoff spot at their place, which is pretty good. And then we went to the playoffs. I pitched game 1 of the playoffs against Wisconsin. In Wisconsin, it was cold, it was wet.
I was gonna say Wisconsin.
It was raining, it was really bad, but
fun game.
Pitched in that game, and then that was unfortunately the last time I got to pitch in the season. We got after we beat Wisconsin the next night at our place, we played Clinton again in the playoffs, and we got done in 3 games.
Yeah, right. Wow. Swept.
And not swept, because it's 3 game series. So we lost.
We won
the first one, they won the second one, and then we got beat in the bottom of the 11th. Walk off. And that was the last game. We lost 1-0.
Oh, that's not bad. I mean, a loss is a loss, but
it's true.
It could be a worse loss.
That's, yeah, we that's the thing. Like, we didn't get smashed, which is good, but we lost 1-0, which is not good at all. Especially when we had plenty of opportunities to win, but that's just the way baseball goes. It's what our coach said. He goes, "You guys obviously gave it your all, and that's all you can do. You got to walk away with your heads up high. You can't go down, oh, that was my fault, or that we could have done so much more when you really, we just got beat by a good baseball team, good defensive baseball
that's
team.
That's a good attitude to have.
Yeah, very optimistic.
And, and then jumped on a plane the next day and flew all the way home. That's my season.
Oh, those Australia to the state flights are, LAX. Did you find LAX or Texas?
I flew home through Dallas. So yeah, I went to Cedar Rapids to Dallas and then Dallas home. Yeah. I actually slept 13 out of the 16 hours.
I was going to say,
I think that's the longest flight, isn't it? I think that's the longest one-way flight.
I think so.
Yeah.
And I slept 13 hours of it. So I was pretty happy.
Yeah, that's good. Lach, how old are you, bud?
I'm 19.
19. See, like, if you're a parent listening to this right now, or you ever want to have kids, you archive this and you save it. You let your kid listen to this, especially if they're in sports. Like, this is a great example of what we do at Grassroots Sports and why we have this podcast, to share stories like this, to let anyone know out there, you know, no matter what age you are, especially young athletes, like, there's so much opportunity to play a sport and to, I guess, get the experience that you're hearing right now from Lach, to be able to travel, to be able to experience going overseas and playing with these clubs, like with the big league experience, what they did with hockey, you know, getting the opportunity to see what a real professional team locker room looks like, or a stadium. It's really different than what we have here. And like you said, like, you walk into that clubhouse and you're like, whoa, like, this is on another level. Definitely, parents, if you have kids and you're listening to this, share this episode with them. I think Lach is a great example of a young athlete who pursued his dream, pursued his goals, didn't let anyone stop him, didn't let any negative talk, and just kept at it, persistent, consistent effort, and is seeing his dream become a reality.
Yeah, and definitely.
It's really good. Oh, so much to chat about still. Mick, how are we doing? Sweet. Awesome. So we're going to keep moving along. So we've been talking a bit about MLB, and I guess I want, your intake a bit more about what baseball looks like in the States compared to what it looks like here.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, obviously, baseball in America is huge.
Yeah.
It's massive. Everywhere you look, there's just people coming to baseball games, either it's in the minor leagues or in the big leagues. Like, there's a lot of teams that will get big crowds each day, each night. They're obviously filling the seats. It's just massive. That's pretty much it. Like, seeing all these people get so involved in baseball, I don't know if it's just Americans themselves, like, they love sport just like Australians do, but yeah, it's impressive, like, seeing all these people go to the game and get, like, into it. Like, they're one of the, like, a part of the team, and yeah, it's impressive.
I think that is the difference between sports here, and in the States. Like, it's really, like you said, like, they're almost a part of the game. Like, the fans are the game, if you will. You know, it's not just about the players, it's not just about the stadium, but it's like the fans are a part of everything that the game is.
Yeah, definitely. There's a lot of, like, the crowd, the hometown crowd will feel the emotions that the hometown feels. Obviously, like, big inning, score a couple runs, everyone's into it. Like, obviously, the opposition team scores a couple runs, oh, damn, we're down. No, there's no talk, there's no nothing. It's just, oh, we'll just sit here and quiet and hopefully something happens. And it's same as opposition spectator coming to a home team, like, they're sitting there trying to get them going, and then home team does the exact same thing. Oh, obviously scores a couple of runs, you see that guy on TV sitting in front of, or sitting with all the hometown people, it's like, oh, I'm just sitting here in front of around all these people, I can't do anything, I'm the only person. So yeah,
that's awesome.
Can we talk a little bit about baseball in Australia, you know, from your experience? Do you think baseball in Australia is on the up, or tell us a little bit about your impressions about baseball in Australia?
I think baseball in Australia is growing, which is definitely a good thing. There's more people going out to the Australian Baseball League games, which in each major city, which is good. Like, attendance levels are on the rise. A lot more people are signing up for baseball, mm-hmm. especially in the younger levels in T-ball.
Yeah.
And it's getting the exposure on social media worldwide as well, especially in Australia. And our Australian baseball team's actually we're in the top 12 now. Oh, after okay. the under-23s team, they came second. They lost to Japan in the championship game a couple weeks ago in Mexico, which is really good. And for an under-strength Australian team to go over there and compete mm-hmm. that well like they did, which was impressive to watch, especially being back home and spectating on an iPad. But, it was really impressive to watch. So, baseball in Australia is definitely growing.
Yeah.
I guess when we talk all about grassroots sports and like where main focus is lacrosse and hockey. And so we kind of see, how governing boards are governing the growth of these games. How have you seen the governing body for baseball in Australia, I guess, promote growth? And would you say they're doing a good job? Would you say, do you support what they're doing and their efforts?
Definitely. Everyone's trying to definitely grow the game. That's why they're there. And, it struggles sometimes to get that exposure, but obviously being a small sport, that's going to happen. Everything's not going to be easy. But with baseball being brought back into the 2020 Olympics in Tokyo,
it's so good.
It's definitely getting there. Australia has realized that, yes, it's coming back, and hopefully with that, it comes back. Australia qualifies for the Olympics, and if it comes on TV, then you are seeing Australian baseball on TV at the Olympics, and it's only going to be a good thing for Australian baseball.
Are you able to qualify for the Olympics for the Australian team?
Yes.
Is that on the cards? Would you like to do that?
Definitely. Yeah, it's on the cards. I would love to represent Australia at the Olympics. I don't think there'd be anything else that I really want to do if it's representing my country. So getting that opportunity to strap on the green and gold at the Olympics, couldn't think of anything else I'd rather want to do.
That's dope.
Do you know how you go about being selected for the Olympics, or that's still a little while off?
I think it's just the same way that the coach selects for any other tournament. Just obviously got to play good.
Yeah.
And hopefully your name's there. Which would be really good. We have the World Baseball Classic coming up in March next year, and so they're currently selecting that team. Myself and my brother are available for that team, so hopefully if all goes our way, we get selected. So which would be really good.
So you obviously play over in the States during the season, so obviously you wouldn't be able to do commit to Australian baseball events when you're playing, but in the off season, are you pretty much a right to play, or is there any restrictions?
I'm allowed to play. It's just if the club, the Minnesota Twins, let me. So this year, obviously, I got shut down for throwing too many innings.
Yeah.
So that's stopped me from playing in the under-23s World Cup and stopped me from playing in the Australian Baseball League. But obviously, if they let me play, I'm allowed to play in the Australian teams in the off-season.
Wow.
I would think that's actually pretty strict. I know in professionals, I know NFL and even in NHL, I'm sure it's the same thing with NBA and everything else, that there's certain things you just can't do. Mm-hmm. I know some sports you can't, random things. Anything that maybe hazardous to your health. Skydiving.
Not let us go off.
Yeah. Really? But in the contract, there's strict things that you can't partake in the off season.
Yeah, definitely. There's extreme sports. Not allowed to do those. That's in the contract.
Not allowed to have any fun.
Not quite, but I don't think Scott jumping out of a perfect little plane is fun.
So you wanted to go on a holiday to the mountains and go skiing, could you do that?
I guess so, but have to be pretty safe at not do anything stupid, try and backflip.
But that's that wouldn't be in your contract or anything that you could.
I wouldn't.
You wouldn't know because your parents looked at the contract.
Well, I read it for that bit. I guess there's certain things you can go and do stuff, just don't injure yourself. Just don't get in a situation where injuries could happen. Mm. So just be safe about it.
I guess it's just understandable that they wouldn't let you play or after a certain pitch count. Just keep the arm healthy and everything.
Yeah, that's definitely it. It's all about maintaining your health and don't want to be injured because
That's not good. Basically your livelihood. Like your arm becomes your livelihood almost. So you want to do everything you can to keep it healthy.
Pretty much put it in cotton wool for 6 months in the office.
Greatest asset. 6 months bubble wrap it.
Bubble wrap came off today, was it? You started throwing today?
I threw yesterday for the first time. So in since September. So felt different. But I'm sure once I start
get those systems in place.
Yeah, the systems. Once I get the systems in place, I'm sure I'll be all right.
I guess a little bit on the admin side of things. So correct me if I'm wrong, not 100% familiar with the situation, but the MLB currently owns the ABL. Is that correct?
A percentage of it.
I'm not sure. I think we came away from the MLB this year. I'm not too sure, but the MLB.
Next game, that's a thumbs up. Yep. So looks like that's right.
Oh, well, there you go. Well, so the ABL is on its own now, but it was owned by Major League Baseball, I think, from the start until obviously this year.
See, I love that they're coming in and supporting that growth.
Yeah, definitely. It's what you need, getting the money in for each club so they can promote and get some players in from overseas to obviously get them, because everyone wants to see an overseas or some talent on their team. They don't want to go and watch, no offense, like Nudge or Nobody or anything like that.
Right. Yeah,
so obviously bringing in talent helps as well. And then, promoting and getting the guys that really want to play there so they can stay at the club.
Absolutely. I guess, going into this season, I mean, what are your thoughts? And obviously, you're probably getting pretty pumped going back into the season. But, what are your thoughts? Are you gunning for, a starting spot on the Twins? And I guess, just elaborate. What are your thoughts going into the season?
Going to go in open-minded. Hope not expect too much for myself, because obviously having high expectations can only lead to disappointment if it doesn't happen. But hopefully go into High A, which is in the Fort Myers Miracle, playing the Florida State League. That's my goal for the next season. And obviously if I start back in Cedar Rapids, obviously work hard like I did at the start of this year to get to that, get to Fort Myers.
Oh, yeah. It's good.
Yeah.
I'm excited for you, man. Definitely looking forward to seeing you continue playing professionally and representing the country. On a side note, Mick just dropped some info on the screen. It says the MLB always intended to remove funding from the ABL when it was deemed to be sustainable. Yeah. Oh, cool. All funding from the MLB is now being directed into an elite training camp in the Gold Coast. There you go. I love that. Growing the game. That's what it's all about. Baseball is doing it right in Australia.
Well, when I was sort of reading up a bit about it last night, I was reading a bit about how the ABL had a certain percentage of stake in the Australian League to make it sustainable. Everyone did that, could you imagine what sport would be like in Australia?
Oh, so good.
Yeah. And now it's reached that point where, baseball in Australia is sustainable and it can support itself.
Which is awesome.
Yeah.
Definitely on the rise. Which is good.
I was going to say, do you think I see from time to time that baseball is on the telly, free-to-air telly as well. Do you think that helps as well, getting kids in involved and people more interested in it?
Yeah, absolutely. Getting it on TV, getting it free-to-air where people can watch it if it's either before kids are going to school or after they come back from school. Seeing it on TV obviously helps me, obviously. Have a dream, so
that's good.
And obviously, people being able to see it can be like, let's go and try this. Let's obviously parents can say, let's go and put the kids in this sport, see if they like it. If they don't like it, all right, they don't like it. Let them try and let them see if
they
do.
Well, that's where this came from. This is mine. My mum put me in baseball for two years or two seasons, I should say, and I asked her to dig this out of the shed for me. It's been there for years. It's in a really bad condition, and I asked Lachlan what I could do to help it, and he said buy a new one. It's in such poor condition.
Wise words.
Wise words. I might just keep it as a prop. Like, it's a beautiful prop.
It does look good.
Sentimental value.
There it goes. Absolutely.
I was like the world's worst baseballer, by the way. Like, seriously. I don't know why my mum did it. I play netball, which is a standard Australian sport, and she's like, no, we're going to pull you out and you can play baseball for two seasons. And quickly, I went back to netball. I was like, I think netball's just my game.
Very soon, lacrosse is going to be the number one women's sport in Australia.
Really?
I'm bank on it. You remember this episode?
Yeah, okay.
Remember this? I'm telling you.
Well, maybe I should try lacrosse as well. I'm going to try derby, so maybe I'll try lacrosse.
Be careful, you'll fall in love with it.
I might even borrow a mitt, a glove, whatever you want to call it. I don't even know what they're called. And pick up baseball again.
Sorry, we forgive you.
Yeah, thank you.
Locke, wrapping up, man. Give us your thoughts on grassroots sports in Australia, man. And what are you thinking? I mean, with baseball, outside of baseball, just grassroots sports in Australia in general. What are your thoughts?
Grassroots sports is nothing better than trying a new sport. If I had, obviously, go out and try it. Like, don't say, oh, it's bad or I don't like it if you've never tried it.
Yeah.
So trying a new sport can only mean good things. Like, you meet new people, meet new friends. You get to try something, go out of your comfort zone, and obviously have fun at it.
Yeah.
Like, first time, you may not be good at it. Second time, you might get a little bit better. But the third time, you finally get it, and you realize, all right, I've done something.
You might actually fall in love with it.
Yeah, that's exactly right. But, grassroots sports, just go out and try it, really. Just give it a crack. And obviously, the more exposure a grassroots sport gets, it turns into a bigger sport and obviously gets popular and it grows.
That's exactly it.
Yeah, that's pretty much what I've got.
That's awesome. It. Phenomenal, man. Yeah,
get amongst it.
So much value in this episode.
Yeah.
Super pumped that we had Locke on. Thanks so much, man.
No problem.
Thanks for having me. Oh, man, it's our pleasure.
Don't worry, we'll be getting you back when you make the Olympics.
That's right. Ooh, definitely.
All right, no pressure.
We'll definitely be on that. But for those who are listening, again, go back and listen to this one, especially if you're a young athlete yourself. Locke's only 19.
Yeah.
I feel like it was yesterday when I was 19. And
it doesn't feel like yesterday for me.
But it's just pursuing your dreams, pursuing your goals. It's really keeping the dream and goals alive. Again, like I mentioned earlier in the show, there comes a point in life where, people start telling us to get real. You know, you got to go to school, get a good job, and, you know, put those dreams away. Or they don't even tell you put those dreams away. It's just like they almost kind of belittle it. You know, once upon a time, we had the picture of Ken Griffey Jr. on the wall or Mark McGwire, and we're just looking at that picture, and it's like, oh, one day I'm going to play there in St. Louis, or one day I'm going to, you know, play with these guys, beat these guys. So you're playing backyard baseball, and you're just like, you know, Sammy Sosa, and you're cracking it, and you're pretending like you're these people. And it's just the dream is alive in you. But then again, as we get older, we start taking those posters off the wall. We start looking for a job, and it's just like, it just dwindles, and it's so sad. But you are, again, a great example of just saying, yep, that's what I'm going to do, and I'm going to pursue it, and this is my dream, and I'm not going to let anyone take it. So I guess thank you for being that example and that individual.
Thank you for being you.
Yes, thank you for being
our pole. I try my best.
Walk the legend. Yeah. But yeah, absolutely. So that's awesome. So that wraps it up for us today, guys.
Yeah.
Super excited to release this one, and again, dropping all those value bombs on all of our listeners. So Black, how can people get a hold of you?
Social media.
What's the handle?
I got Twitter handle. It's Lachlan Wells 1. And Instagram _ Lachlan Wells.
Absolutely.
So get around it and give us a follow, please.
That's right. Go ahead and bump those numbers out for him and just follow his journey. Follow his story. It's an epic story, and it's only going to get better.
Yeah.
In regards to grassroots, we're at Twitter at @grassroots_AU, Instagram @grassroots_sports, and Facebook @grassrootssports. As always, thank you, Earth Movers, for hanging out with us in Thought Fox Studio 1. And continue to show love and continue to share. We love having you guys. We love hanging out with you guys. So make sure if you're watching on YouTube, click the red button below, subscribe, leave a comment. Love the interaction with you guys, as well as iTunes. Make sure you download and leave us a comment. All it does is help us get valuable content like this into people's ears like yours. So until next time, guys, you're hanging out with us in Thought Fox Studio 1, also known as the Fox Den.